Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah, you are great, mighty, and awesome. The transcendent God who bestows loving kindness, creates everything out of love, remembers the love of our fathers and mothers, and brings redemption to their children's children for the sake of the divine name. We come before you this night in the midst of our Lenten faith journey, seeking healing, wholeness. Loving Father, forgive us for our feelings of jealousy, which we know are not righteous and very detrimental for our well-being, our health, our relationships. Help us, Lord, to develop attitudes of contentment and peace, which we know only comes from you. Conform our minds and thoughts to your thoughts, Lord. Take complete control of us through the Holy Spirit, so that we will not do our will, but only yours. We pray that we will be more and more you, and walk and talk you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you read with me, these are portions of Psalm 32, and we will read together. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. Then I acknowledged my sin to you. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Let all the faithful praise you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty water will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad. Righteous, sing, all you who are upright in heart. So, here we go. My name is Eleazar the Third. You might remember my grandfather from the story about Isaac and Rebekah. That's in Genesis 24. You see, my family was still with Isaac when Jacob left for Haran to meet his new wife. He hadn't seen her yet, but that's what he was going to go for. At least that's what the storyline went. And this part really isn't in the Bible, but it ought to be because it leaves me out. But you see, just so that he might be cared for, and protected, and give another set of eyes on Jacob, because you know how he was. Isaac gave several of his servants to Jacob on his way to Haran to sort of, you know, make things safe. So given my family history with Isaac, I was designated to go with Jacob, and I was sort of the first servant in charge of all the others. It's pretty good gig if you can get it, until I found out more. There's always more, isn't there? Because then Rebecca says, well, Eli 3, you be careful. Be careful, because I'm not really sure how long he's going to be gone. Well, I didn't like the sound of that. So I thought about it a little while, and I realized that I knew about that birthright debacle thing. And I had heard, it was hard not to hear about the threat of death that Esau put upon Jacob. So, then there's also a lot of stories that grandfather had told me about Abraham and Isaac and some of those family histories of this group. So I had a pretty good idea there's going to be some kind of surprises along the way. So I was sort of glad I didn't have a lot to pack up. So I gathered the few things I had, pretty much all of my belongings, and off we went. And I got to tell you, I mean, we knew it was going to be more than a three-hour tour, but it turned into this three-decade-long journey. And, well, it's just, it makes it difficult. And, you know, well, but you're starting to get a little dark around here. And Jacob wanted to stop and camp at this river. And then he decided he wanted to be upstream by himself tonight. And he sent everybody else in a couple of different directions. Well, I disagreed with him, but I don't always get my way. I'm just sort of unsure about how safe he's going to be, because he sends away for our safety. So I just got a suspicion it's going to be a long night. And so I plan to stay awake all night long, just in case Jacob yells out and needs me. And if you could help me stay awake, that would be really, really great. I tell you what, I'll make a bargain with you. I'll trade some of my stories if you'll just sit up with me. How about that? Is that a doable thing?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Great. We have a deal. That's what they call it in Jacob's family, a deal. So where can I start telling you stories you'd really like to know? Because I'm not an expert in human psychology. I admit that. I've been around this family long enough to know not to be surprised by how they treat each other. Because Jacob's trickery over Esau, it was life-changing for everybody. Not just those two, but for everybody. That ripple effect went through everybody's life. But it really wasn't all that surprising. Well, except the fact that the idea came from his mom. That was a little surprising. And then particularly scary, really, because his mom just happens to be the sister of this guy, Laban, whose home we're trying to find. And that was a little scary. So I stayed ready for pretty much anything. And it didn't take long for just pretty much anything to happen. I mean, so you got to get this picture. Jacob, and he's not a young guy now, okay? He's not a teenager. And we come up over this ridge, and in the distance, he sees sheep. And he sees a couple of guys sitting around what looks to be a well. He figures this must be the good spot. These people will know who Laban is. Well, you see, we just got to the well, and here come these sheep. And right with the sheep is this pretty young lady named Rachel. I glanced over at Jacob. I saw this puppy dog looking face, and I knew that her beauty arrows and the gentle enveloping smile that she had, it just struck home, and they wrapped him up with such amazing accuracy. I mean, that boy was in love. He didn't have a chance. He was so much in love with Rachel that Laban, her father, had no problem getting him as well. It took him 4 weeks, and then he had Jacob. Jacob just didn't know it. Jacob offers, I just couldn't believe it. He offered to work for Laban for 7 years. Get it? 7 years so that he can marry Rachel. And I knew that was a bad deal because Laban took about 4 seconds to say, absolutely, where do we sign the papers? Let's do it. You drive a hard bargain. Well, I always felt a little uneasy how easy all that went down. But yeah, Jacob's happy. He's giddy. He's just floating all the time for 7 years. He's just blinded by all of this. And like I said, I was just didn't feel right about it, but he wouldn't listen to me. Well, you see, Rachel had an older sister, still does, I guess. Her name's Leah. But Leah's nice enough. But she's not that beauty queen, knock you down when you first see her kind, like Rachel is. And they were pretty close in age. And from a distance, they had some, they looked fairly similar in type of body build and height and stature and that sort of thing. That might be one explanation for the delay in Jacob's discovery that one awesome morning. You see, the 7 years went by, and the wedding came, and the wedding night came, and then the next morning came, and all of a sudden Jacob wakes up and he realizes he is with not Rachel, he's with Leah. He is not happy. He's madder than I've ever seen him in his entire life, and I've known him his entire life. I thought Jacob's head was going to explode. I really did. If he didn't explode Laban's head first. But I learned something that day. Laban is the smoothest talking person I've ever met. Because he went from almost being killed in his tracks. And within 2 or 3 minutes, everything was calm. Everything was fine. Laban's okay. He's safe. He's going to live through it. Leah's still going to be a wife. And Rachel will be Jacob's wife. And Jacob's okay. And Jacob's happy. It's only going to cost him another 7 years. I said, the man has lost his mind. 7 more years. And just like that, the scoreboard reads, Laban 1, Jacob 0. And that's when I knew where Rebecca got all her talent. She and Laban were two peas of the same pod. So things started happening right away. I'm not sure how well the sisters got along before Jacob got there, but I can tell you that there's a lot of tension, and there's always something going on between those two after the two marriages. There's always some kind of contest going on about how many nights Jacob's going to stay with each wife. Of course, Rachel was almost undefeated in that contest, but that's who Jacob loved. That made Leah very envious and very sad. But she made up the score real quick because they found out that Leah was pregnant. And she's pregnant first. Yeah. So when the baby comes, she names the baby Reuben. It means something about God looking upon her with favor. And now that God does that, then her husband will love her. But about her husband loving her, that didn't happen. But spending time, yep, that happened. She had 3 more sons. Simeon, which would mean something about, first child was named Reuben. It means something about God looking upon her with favor in all of her affliction, and now her husband will love her. Not really. So she had these 3 other sons. Simeon, I'm hated, she says. This is what the name means. Wouldn't you want to have that name? Because I'm hated. But God loves me and gives me a son. Then there's Levi. After 3 sons, surely my husband will love me. And then son number 4, Judah. And this time, the name says, I'm not acknowledging my husband on this job. I'm praising God. This is all God. Well, meanwhile, it just seems like Rachel will never have children. And as in the custom it was of the day, her dad had given her a maid named Bilhah. And it was perfectly acceptable for her to give an order to Bilhah to go and be with her husband and have a child, which she does. There's no reference that I read in the reports that she complained about that. And it happens. And there's Dan. Good old Dan. The Lord has heard me and given me a son. Pretty good name. And then it happens again. This one is called Naphtali. I've wrestled and tussled with my big sister, and I won. Ooh. See what I mean? They may not have come right out and argue with each other, but the way they named their children? Wow. Just exceptionally envious and jealous of each other. But two can play at this, I'll give my maid to my husband and have a child game. So guess what? Leah now does it. So she went and had her maid, Zilpah. Zilpah sleeps with Jacob. And it happens again. This time it's Gad. And Leah says, well, that's good fortune for me. And you guessed it happens again. And there's Asher. I am so happy, says Leah. I really think that last name was a shot at Rachel. I really do. Because the scoreboard was Leah 6, Rachel 2. And Rachel's score had a little asterisk beside it, like they do in the record books, that says, well, while she gets credit, they really aren't hers. She didn't go through the pain of childbirth, so it only sort of partially counts. She never got pregnant with children. I don't know what it was about those two. At this point, though, they were barely talking to one another. I don't know. There's so many dynamics going on in that family. And when it comes to women, I am not the person to ask for advice. But I know that I saw two very unhappy people. And they were unhappy for a variety of reasons. I mean, I could never figure out, no matter how much I eavesdropped or how many questions I felt bold enough to ask, how much they knew and what they knew and when they knew it about the switch at the wedding. I think it has to mess with your emotions, though. When you don't have any say as to who you're going to marry or when you want to marry them or why you want to marry them. I also wondered how much Rachel knew. You know, but did dear old dad trick her too? Did he just force her into something that, or out of something that she wanted to do? I don't know. Or maybe it was Rachel's idea. She felt sorry for Leah. And so this would be a great way to help loveless, helpless Leah. Regardless of the reason, it all resulted in trust issues and hostility and envious nature of this family. Anyway, Rachel still wanted more children. She especially wanted her own child. So one day, she finds out that Leah has some kind of herbs that her son found. It's called mandrakes. And they were thought at the time to have some sort of fertility-inducing characteristics. Well, she's desperate. She was desperate. She's going whatever she could do. So she goes to Leah and says, I'll tell you what, I'll make a trade with you. You give me some of the mandrakes, and I'll make sure Jacob gets on your calendar. And guess what? It happens. Leah has Issachar, who says, God gave me Jacob because I gave him my maid. I don't know where they get those things. And it happened again. Zebulon, God has given me a dowry. My husband will honor me because I have 6 sons. And then just to put a final touch of emphasis on it, she has a daughter named Dinah. Well, by this time, the two women, not only are they not speaking to each other, they hardly even look at each other. They can't even stand to be in the same space. And there's a lot of, well, you go tell my sister so-and-so, or that other lady over there, or they're telling people to tell somebody to tell the other person something. But I look back on it, I said that the situations are reversed at that point. The youngest was the happiest and was supposed to be the happiest. And she was going to be first married, and she's going to give the first grandchild for Laban. And the eldest was going to be forlorn. She's the one who's going to be forsaken and feeling unloved. But now, the youngest is miserably unhappy. She was the last married, and she has offered Dad no grandchildren. Well, one day, it happened. She finds out she's pregnant, and Rachel gives a name to that event. God is no longer ignoring me. And the child comes, they name him Joseph. May the Lord give me another son. I heard that name and wondered, I understood all of the left-handed compliments from Leah, but I'm not sure how Joseph is going to take being named a wish for another son. That's just me. But there you have it. That's the storyline of this family, man. It's envy and jealousy and deception and animosity and fear and loneliness every time you turn around. If I had any kind of power at all, I would have been gone. But fortunately, once Joseph came along, Jacob says, well, now that I've got my real son from my real wife that I really love, we can go back home. I can take all my stuff. I can go back home. But then he realizes that he really is sort of stuck there with Laban. So he goes to Laban, and he tried to make Laban another arrangement, another deal. He's a little smarter this time, though. He had a plan in mind. He's going to leave wealthy. He's going to take sheep and children and goats and all sorts of stuff that he thinks are his, that he deserves, and he's going to take them from Laban. And he's going to convince Laban that that's the right thing to do. Well, before all that could happen, and before the ink was dried on the paper, Laban's sons start complaining because Jacob seems to have all the wealth. Laban says, you know, all of that stuff is mine. The daughters, the grandchildren, the goats, the sheep, it's all mine. It's not his. He's a foreigner in this place. So Jacob got scared. And so he rounded up all the stuff, all the cattle, all the sheep, all the goats, got his wives together to help him make a decision. I looked at that and I said, man, I don't understand you. These two people who've not spoken in 6-7 years, who don't like each other, who only don't fight with each other physically because people stop them from doing it, you want to ask them to come together and help you make a decision? He said, yes, sir, E3. That's exactly what I want to do. Well, it's the first time since I've been there, and it's been almost 20 years, that I've witnessed these two sisters act like sisters and have a conversation and hear this plan. And then I realized that they were agreeing because they had a common enemy. Neither one of them liked that at all. And they would do whatever it took to get away from Laban. Even if it meant going with Jacob halfway around the world to go back to his place. So they decided to support Jacob. They took all the children and the belongings and they left. Well, sometimes things look good on paper, but you just don't get all of the extra consequences, you know? I think they call them secondary and tertiary consequences to this decision. Laban was able to chase us down. He wasn't loaded up like we were. And now Laban is angry. And if you think he's smooth talking when he's not angry, he's anything but that when he is angry. So he ran into Jacob. But Jacob has learned some finesse now because he's been hanging around with Laban for all this time. And now he's got off the charts. He's supported by sweet Rachel and sweet Leah and all those things. And we didn't mean to hurt you, Dad. But it was, you know, the rain was coming, the storm, and the darkness was, and if we didn't go now, we would do, and all these excuses. But then come to find out, one of the things Dad was looking for was these little statues that he called gods. He had them on his mantle back home, and now they're missing. And he wants to know who's got them, because he's almost absolutely past positive that they've got them. Jacob says, we don't have them. If you find them anywhere, you can have the person do whatever you want to, but the person has got them. I'll never forget the look on Jacob's face. Because after Dad finally was convinced that they didn't have them, they left. And Jacob said, I hope he finds them. And Rachel said, no, he won't find them. Because Rachel stole them. And she hid them. And then she lied to him that she didn't know where they were while she was sitting right on top of him. And Jacob, I think, had that same puppy dog look that I saw some 14 years old. He loved that girl. Now, there's some emotional story behind what Rachel did. And one day I'm going to find out. It's getting almost dawn, folks. You've been a good audience. I thought maybe you'd appreciate some of that drama. It's involved in all those stories from that whole family as far back as you can go in the genealogy. But I heard you guys were fans of stuff like that because you watched Dallas and Falcon Crest and all that kind of stuff. So I'm not sure what the next few days will bring to this group of people. Before I left the camp up there with Jacob, he said he was working on some idea about sending the family forward tomorrow. Because at some point in the next few days, he expects they're going to run into Esau. And if he sends the family in waves, like sending Bilhah and Zilpah first with their kids, and then maybe another day or half day later, he sends Leah and her children. And then a day or so later, he'll come with Rachel and Joseph. And Rachel's pregnant. Did you know that? You wouldn't have known that. Rachel's pregnant. And she's just floating, so it doesn't hurt her to walk. I'm not sure what's going to happen, though, when Jacob shares that story and Leah finds out that she's in the lead to protect Rachel. It may happen all over again. But maybe it won't. Maybe it'll work. Maybe Esau will have some compassion when he sees all of this parade of family. And when Leah gets there, she will tell them all about the good Jacob that she seems to know. And maybe he'll have compassion. Maybe we'll all be able to live through it. Aren't families great, though? Aren't they? I mean, just when you think you've got them all figured out, they change the rules on you. Somebody has a new desire to take something that you thought was yours. Or they decide they're going to take the last cookie out of the jar. Or they're going to take all the cookies out of the jar. Or ever-changing. And you don't always get to choose your family. I've heard this phrase about blood being thicker than water for a long time, and I'm just not sure about that stuff anymore. I'm really not. I am pretty sure, though, that blood is a lot messier than water.
prayers and join within your people here.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.